gentlemen, at the same time, allow me to also ask for special protection from the Honorable Speaker. Just like what I did to take the stick on your behalf, I will also be the firing line and try to tell the policymakers the truth. I think we have the questions that were being asked by the Deputy Governor, Dr. Mulambo, where you are saying what exactly is the problem. So I'll try to also respond to that and tell him the truth from the other side, because we are the ones affected by policy when it's introduced. But before I do that, as I was leaving my seat to come to the stage, the Deputy Minister, Dr. Bangwiro, said to me, you conveniently dodged the question on paying for electricity in foreign currency. So allow me to respond to that right now and then tie it to the subject that we are discussing right now. I'd like to believe even Dr. Matsikanda will acknowledge that there are some players who are already doing that, who are already paying for electricity in foreign currency. They have special arrangement with ZESA, and particularly after the other time when we were having long periods of load shedding, it was one issue that we assist with, negotiating with the authorities to allow those that are generating foreign currency to pay in foreign currency. So some are doing that. So probably it's an issue of more doing the same, particularly those that are generating foreign currency. But also allow me to extend it, because even the other players, because they want a guaranteed supply of energy, they would wish to also do the same and have guaranteed power. Because we may talk renewable energy, talk generators, talk solar, the cheapest form of energy for industry remains grid power. So when you have that guarantee, you are better off. So what has been constraining other businesses from not doing the same and get guaranteed power is the issue of foreign currency, because there is no legitimate way of getting foreign currency and paying for local services. You cannot go to the auction that we are discussing right now and get electricity, get foreign currency to pay for either fuel or electricity. So that's the other bit, which is linked to the topic that we are discussing right now. So what it means is that for me to be able to also do the same, I have to do something, probably in the line of managing disruptive change. And this is exactly the reason why the Deputy Governor here was saying at times people try to seek opportunities. But you realize that as business leaders, there are instances that we face which force us to do certain things to survive, because you will be in trouble. I want to say more on that, but I would like to believe everyone else there understands. When the Deputy Governor was speaking, he said that those who are in grain and fuel have their own separate arrangement when it comes to getting a foreign currency. You then wonder why almost all the service stations are selling fuel in foreign currency, because we would anticipate that they are getting the foreign currency in that other way. They should surely sell in other TGS at the prevailing rate. That is what one would understand. And then that leads to the next question, that for everyone sitting in this room who is not exporting and is not getting foreign currency, service stations are selling in foreign currency. So how did you drive to this conference? Where did you get your fuel? So this is where the issue is. People are now forced to go to where the foreign currency is available, or to where the fuel is available at an agreed price, which is negotiated between the two parties. Because at the end of the day, other than the rate that came from the auction, you are then forced, because you want the service, to pay the right price. I think the two presenters before me touched the important issue of the exchange rate. And when we are talking about the challenges that we have been facing as business with regards to the auction, is that exchange rate, the exchange rate that has been coming from the auction. Is it the correct exchange rate? Is it a floating exchange rate? Is it genuinely being calculated from the bills? That is information that they can provide us from their account. But honestly, from where we are as business people and as private individuals, we feel that the exchange rate is being managed. We could be incorrect, but surely there should be ways to make us understand the correct way that the exchange rate is being generated. But this exchange rate that we got, which could be correct, which could be managed, which could be fixed, has got serious consequences on everybody. We find when this thing started, everyone else thought it was just an issue for those that are importing. But believe you me, of which I can't tell you that, because you know that it is affecting the entire industry. Everybody, in fact, including private individuals. Why? Because it's affecting contracts. If I don't know if PRAS are here, but all entities that procure through PRAS for the contracts, they are now pegging them at the independent. So the contract is denominated in USD, and then it will be paid at prevailing independent. At the same time, when you sign that contract with them and you want to service that contract, it is either you need to get your money from the auction at that rate, which will be good for you if you manage to do that. But in most instances, because of the shortages and the limits, you may not be that fortunate to get it. Yet you have a contract to service. At the same time, the other services that you are getting to service that contract, they are coming at the black market or parallel market rate, whichever term you want to use to describe it. So what it means like right now is you sign a contract for $1,000 and then you go, you get your services from somebody who has used their rate, official of 90, which you'll be paid by your 1,000, services accessed at 180. So you now have an option now of, are you gonna not deliver on the contract and just say, let's wait for the auction for us to get, because you find you can submit one bid, 1 week, one invoice through one bank with the limit at the times the part allocate. So you want 100,000, you are told your bid got 50, and the 50 right now is not yet available. This is a practical problem from a business person who has entered into a contract to deliver within a certain period. It's hell, I tell you, ladies and gentlemen. I can't explain more, but you understand that. Still on this issue of the official rate, let me put another scenario. Because we've been looking at ways of trying to manage it. Disruptive change. We said at some point, let's now only accept nostrum payments. Yes, we know there's a law that says you can't refuse RTGS. But like I said, I'm in the firing line, I'll say the truth. There are some when we told customers that, look, for this service, because we are importing, put money in nostrum. Money gets into nostrum. All local payments now have 20% surrender requirements. So 20% is taken away, goes to RBZ. It's liquidated at the official rate. So I got 1,200 at official rate, multiplied by 90. And then I remember the other time talking to the governor himself, he's not here, raising this similar issue. And he then said to me, no, there's no point there. Because it's liquidated at 90, you can still follow it and get it from the auction if you need it. You get that. Of which I'm hearing answers there, because people know it's difficult. So, doctor, you help the people. At least we are more. Okay, so now, my point here is, if you don't get it from the auction, and then you become creative and manage disruptive change to deliver, and then you go there, you access service at 180, effectively, you have lost 50% of the amount that was taken. Globally, that translates to 10% of the value of the transaction. And in most cases, because of competition, probably your profit margin was 15. So 10 is already gone. it's a serious issue. And as business people, I urge you to look at that very closely, because you could be doing projects and very happy because you've not paid attention, and then you wonder at the end of the day, why have I not made money? So that is very critical. It's also an issue linked to that exchange. So that's the nostro scenario. Thirdly, in my other life, I sit on the board of Zimtrade, where we are trying to improve the country's exports in line with the mandate that was given by His Excellency. Grow exports by 10% every year. And I am in the Export Development Committee. And in that committee, we interact with the exporters. And one issue that came out from the exporters, again linked to these exchanges that we are talking about right now, because there are also surrender requirements. When the forex comes into the country, it's also surrendered. So in the same analysis that I gave you of the 200 that was surrendered, and then 10% of the transaction is lost, it's also the same for the exporters. And it's now affecting export competitiveness. So they were saying, gentlemen, yes, you want us to export more, but right now if I get a customer that says rated 180, because I know it's the realistic rate, because it's being accepted there, I would make money from a local transaction that comes in RTGS. So this is actually affecting national vision as we try to improve exports. And it's a result of this exchange rate that we're talking about, which is coming from this auction. Already we have heard from CCU about the delays in disbursements. We then do not understand it when you hear the deputy governor saying we have surpluses in foreign currency. Because what you anticipate is that when we have surpluses, at least the bids that you accepted and allotted, let them be paid. Precisely. Someone say it. Let them be paid so that we feel the surplus. So the problem is that I think there's been so much talk about surpluses, fair and fine, but on the ground, it's not being felt. Honorable Speaker, I hope the protection is there. I'm saying the truth. Then over and above this, sorry, let me just say it. I think it's important. Over and above this, we have had promises from RBC. They issue a statement and say the backlog is going to be cleared in the next 30 days. And then it does not happen. So you find at times you wait, and then, because it hasn't happened, no one believes them anymore. Last week they issued another statement. To me personally, it was very worrying. Where they said, because we picked, there were some issues happening on the beach that came, I think, before 21 September. So we are ring-fencing those bids. And then from the bids from 21 September going forward, we will clear. The deputy governor also alluded to the fact that from 4 October they've already started. But it's the bids from 21, I think after 21 September, you can correct me. But there are other bids from before that date, which is that backlog. They are saying they've ring-fenced those bids. Let me say this, ladies and gentlemen. I'm uncomfortable personally about this idea of ring fencing. Why? We also had previously, we used to call them legacy dates. They changed to blocked funds. We were told that they are also ring fenced. Unfortunately, the RTGS portion is actually taken at that very moment from your account, because it's ring fenced and you are given a guarantee to be processed. And up to now, I don't know how many years, we were assisted with this matter for some of our members. The money went, it 1:1, but up to now, those blocked funds have not yet been remitted to the external suppliers, which is an important point. So my problem with the current ring fencing is that you are ring fencing again, but you are taking the RTGS again. The RTGS is going to be eroded while it's ring fenced. In the end, probably, it will die a natural death. So personally, as Kamgerem, I'll be more comfortable if they cancel those bids. They say there were problems. They were sponsoring a show of companies. Fair and fine, all previous bids cancelled. And then people get the RTGS and start participating going forward. They don't want that, because they also want to manage money supply. But please, it's not everyone who was using share of companies. And for that matter, let's not punish everybody. This is an appeal that I'm giving to the deputy governor, a here present. So the problems, there are many. You can explain them better than me, but let me also touch on what I think are the recommendations quickly, because I'm seeing the main is up, so that in the interest of time, people can discuss. We said we have adopted the Dutch auction system. Economists are very good at this. They know the rules of the Dutch auction system. Let's just follow the rules to the letter and spirit. That's my recommendation number one. Follow that to the letter and spirit. And everyone, we have confidence in the system. But if the rules are known and then we appear like we are dribbling and we are going aside, people won't have confidence. And you end up behaving in the way they are doing. That's point number one. And most importantly, what is more important is we are not clear of how things are happening within the auction system. Bids just go. And then you don't know what happens. They just get feedback. At times you are told you are not successful, yet the reason is not given. There's need for more transparency. Even the figure for auctioning, let it be known so that bids are submitted based on the figure. That's known. It's critical for that. And then for my dear exporters, on this one I'll accept that term now. When exporters had their money surrendered at the official rate, I hope the rate will be allowed to go up to equilibrium. Reinforce that and to make sure that when they want the forex, they get it. Because those are the soldiers that are bringing forex.